Ford Mondeo presents Young Turks.
Hello and welcome to Young Turks, CNBC India's brand new show dedicated to the next generation of managers. I'm Menaka Doshi in Mumbai, and this week I'll be talking to food king Sanjay Narang.
I'm Shireen Bhan in New Delhi, and join me today as I take a walk through the corridors of Bath to meet one of the young promising ministers in the present Union Cabinet. But first, Menaka's got with her gourmet guru Sanjay Narang, so let's go back to Menaka. Menaka?
Well, thank you, Shireen. But before we actually do meet Sanjay Narang, here's a brief rundown on his run-up to success. He's a dishy young man, quite literally, with a restaurant for almost every year of his life. Was he born into it? Well, yes, still a bitter family separation left his father and him with just a few useless properties. But Sanjay had the gumption to transform them.
The goal was not to reinvent Indian cuisine, but to cater to everyday eating out requirements. In 5 years, Narang opened a jazz bar, a South Indian fast food chain, a diner chain, a chain of bakery shops, a chain of modern-day dhabas, a boutique hotel, and an airline catering unit. The man has boundless energy.
I think enthusiasm of enjoying what you do. I sleep very well. I think that comes from a clear mind. And I really get up every day completely fresh, no matter what happened the previous day. And I enjoy the challenges of a new day.
How difficult is it to break into the restaurant or the hospitality business in India as an entrepreneur?
We were lucky and the timing was right. The whole thing of disposable incomes going up, people going out more often, all that combined with our entering into the market at that time probably allowed us to be successful more quickly than otherwise.
Where did you get your initial funding from? And as your business grew, where did all the money come from? How difficult was it to convince people?
Very, very difficult. The first restaurant we started was quite literally by borrowing and, you know, I won't say begging, but we really had to run around to borrow. Banks are known for lending money to those who don't need it, and when you need it, they never lend to you. So basically, the first restaurant was successful. Fortunately, the property already was there, so we only had to invest into the renovation. It did very well, touch wood, and from that, from the profits of that, we did the second, the third, and then we went out into the equity market to look at venture capital funding. And after a lot of doing the rounds and trying to convince people that this business can run in a very transparent manner, in a very open way, which that's a lot of apprehension that the restaurant business, you know, people generate a lot of cash and you can't control the system. Investors worry about that, and I think we were able to successfully show them that we have a phenomenal reporting and MIS control system that is in place, that, you know, the accountability, the transparency of how we deal. I think that's ultimately what convinced them, and we got ICICI Ventures to invest with us for an initial round of funding and then a second round of funding for all these restaurants.
Each of Narang's 35 restaurants is catered to by a central commissary like this one, where all the raw materials are processed. This ensures economies of scale and standardization of food quality. Consistency is Narang's favorite word.
I honestly think that, you know, eating out is not just about food anymore. It's about the overall experience you have. You like the decor, which may be cheerful, bright, there's music playing in the background, the AC works, it's nice and cool. The food is ultimately, obviously, the heart of the whole thing. But I think what we're able to successfully do is consistently give a standard across all our brands.
Where do these ideas come from?
We basically have an initial idea based on gut instinct. We've never done market research or anything like that. We think we're normal people, and the types of things we'd like to go to are what primarily everyone would like to go to.
Are you a food buff?
Should I give you the restaurant owner answer or the truth? I'm a complete junk food eater. I eat burgers and pizzas and all that, and I don't have any sort of quality of taste. I'm just the orchestrator or the facilitator of making a group of people work very well.
Narun's forte is detailed planning and he plans to perfection. He also emphasizes strongly on organizational systems and structures. The idea is to make himself totally dispensable. So he has a management board that runs the business and operation manuals for each restaurant. If he were to disappear, the business would still go on.
I think the successful formula in business has to be the ability to, you know, create systems and processes for everything you do. It should not be based on strengths and weaknesses of individuals, whether it be the CEO or whether it be a restaurant manager. So you try to sensitize your business as much away from individuals as you can and make it driven by procedures that are there.
You've got it really well organized. Where does that come from?
I went to Cornell University, and it inculcated in your mind there that how systems and reporting procedures and how an organization chart should be set up and what area should be, you know, you shouldn't be too top heavy, etc.
Have you actually copied this model of working?
To be honest, no. I can't think even of a company in India or abroad which runs a portfolio of 8 or 9 brands of restaurants. It's a unique situation. We, of course, the whole concept of training and making sure we have laid down procedures and all comes from seeing all the successful fast food businesses of the world, be it McDonald's or Pizza Hut, and all the people who have been there for decades before us. And but I think the concept of having a portfolio of brands, so you don't put all your eggs in one basket, so to speak. You know, the chance of all types of foods falling out of favor is very remote as compared to just one, maybe.
How do you deal with those changing tastes, changing fashions?
We are constantly adapting our menu. We have an elaborate system which tells us what items are selling more and less, which comes out of a computer-generated system on a weekly basis. So we revise our menus and upgrade them and change them normally every 5 to 6 months.
He moves fast. His team can open a restaurant in less than 45 days. This penchant for speed will help him serve up another 65 restaurants in 3 years, including a Chinese fast food chain, coffee lounges, and a Sachin Tendulkar chain of restaurants. Tendulkar actually is Sanjay's hero. So is tennis star John McEnroe.
John McEnroe, because of his ability to clearly understand that heroes are not people who are just gifted. Heroes are people who do things that are great. And Sachin, because he's such a humble guy.
Okay, will it always be fast food, or will you actually consider doing more, not just jazz by the way kind of restaurants?
I think we would, much fewer and much lesser, so unless there's a concept that is really exciting, like the Sachin Tendulkar restaurant, you know, the sports theme and all that, in a very different way. It's all about him and the foods he likes, and he's an amazing food eater. I mean, you've never seen a foodie like him.
You also draw a lot of inspiration from your mother.
I lost my mom when I was quite young, and I think I have tried to build the basis of my life around whatever she told me was right and wrong. It allows you to very easily stay on the straight path, that as I would put it, and not fall towards temptation.
So what do you do in your free time when you're not conceptualizing a restaurant or not giving into temptation?
To be honest, work is so much fun that you start your day early and you finish it off pretty late. And I wouldn't really say it's work. We're just enjoying ourselves. There isn't really much else outside that. I also think that's wrong, and I wouldn't advocate this to anyone. You need to have a balance.
Okay, any regrets?
Not married.
Well, he's almost Mr. Nice Guy, isn't he? Candid and down-to-earth, Narang admits that despite owning 35 restaurants, he prefers dining at this small roadside Chinese eatery in a Mumbai by-lane.
Terrific food, that's the truth. When you go to your own restaurant, you're always like on duty and you're looking at everything, the light bulb is fused and this not there, so you never feel that comfortable. And this is just a place with great food and you can do your own things.
Stay tuned as Shireen meets the new face of politics in India, Rajiv Pratap Rudi, Minister of State for Commerce and Industry. But that's after this short break.
Welcome back, and you're watching Young Turks. The man we meet today is as comfortable in his signature Fab India kurtas as he is scuba diving in Lakshadweep. Meet Rajiv Pratap Rudi, the Minister of State for Commerce and Industry, whose journey from regional politics to the Union Cabinet has been a carefully crafted one.
Rudi's climb to these corridors of power began at age 26 in a remote district of Bihar. But his initiation to politics happened just 200 kilometers from New Delhi in Chandigarh. Elected as the president of the Student Union of Punjab University, he was the first non-Punjabi to win the post. Not unusual to campus politics, he was kidnapped twice and even shot at. For Rudi, this was just an occupational hazard, not enough to throw him off track. He's one of the few exceptions of Indian politics who has made it despite having a political godfather.
No, I didn't have a political godfather. I didn't have a political background. There was no one in my family in politics. And it's just amazing. And so I call it destiny. And I took a risk when all my friends in my department and contemporary studies, they were preparing for the UPSC, someone was going in the armed forces. I went back to a very remote rural area and started working. And that was my native place, so I started working. And in 5 years, just 5 years, continuously working on a, had a motorcycle, I used to carry my sleeping bag, which was never seen in a village. So I used to carry a sleeping bag, go from village to village, organize people. And in just 5 years, I could rally everyone to become the youngest MLA in Bihar then.
Politics is not really seen as a career choice by a lot of people, by the majority. But would you, for instance, want your children to join politics? Would you want your daughters to join politics?
It may be difficult to get into politics. But once you get into politics, in a country like India with a population of 1,000 million, you can deliver a lot and there is no competition. If good people do not come in politics, some person will get elected. And things would become difficult because
now, your name was also brought up as far as the Tehelka exposure was concerned. Was that one of the most trying points in your political career, and how did that change you really?
No, I think since we have a press which is free, anyone can write anything, and we as politicians have become susceptible. Now if anyone writes anything, prima facie it is taken that look, he's in the wrong, which is not true. Someone should have asked me. I would say Tehelka is a situation where the arms vendor in this country united to see that George Fernandez, who is one of the best defense ministers ever this country has had, is thrown out.
Would you say that there is no corruption in Indian politics? Would you say that's an aberration as well? That the instances
no,
of
corruption, I would never say there is no corruption in politics, there is no corruption in bureaucracy, there is no corruption in business, there is even corruption in press. I don't want to quote it, but there are better people in bureaucracy, there are better people in politics, there are better people in press, there are better people in business. You cannot take that as an example for the society.
I would like to tell them that they are the economy of this country.
These are tough times for not just his party, but his ministry too. With the Indian economy riding a trough, Rudi says there's only one way out, reforms. But pushing them through can often be difficult as they fall prey to partisan politics.
Now there are reforms which have to be brought in. The process of reforms which started in 90 saw a new situation called the WTO.
Right.
And after that we are seeing a different situation now. Reforms for labor has to be brought in. Because once you take up a reform process, a consensus has to be built up in this country. And a consensus means a consensus of 1,000 million people and hundreds of political parties and persons. Now you have to cross that hurdle.
Politics doesn't give Rudi much time for the family. Vacations aside, even dinner together is rare. But once he's home, the politician takes a back seat. From then on, he's just dad.
What are the sort of sacrifices that you've made to balance a political career and to balance quality family time? Have you made more sacrifices, or do you think what sacrifices are really made by the family?
I have a wife who's young, I have a daughter who's 10-year-old, another daughter who's just 2-year-old. Now, it is criminal not to spend time with them. I know it. I see the anger of my wife every second day. Every evening is almost, unless until I make extraordinary efforts to appease her. She also works. She has a profession. She takes care of the children. She goes out. She prepares for everything. That way I have been very selfish. I admit. But I will not admit it to her.
So what are the extraordinary measures that you take to appease her?
make extraordinary efforts. But that, I make efforts. It's impossible to make your wife happy is rather impossible. But still one keeps trying. And then I talk to my friends and I say, how do you all manage it? And then I find that everyone is doing the same. So that gives me some consolation.
Do you miss having spent that time with your children to have really seen them grow up?
Now that you are doing a serial or a show on young people in politics, this is what is costing them dearly. Because we have come at a point where we think God has been kind enough, that you have got more than you deserved. Now then you want to live up to it. You don't want to fail. You don't want to fail the people who have brought you here. You don't want to fail the system. You want to work overtime. You are straining yourself. You are trying to know everything. You are trying to work everything. You are trying to interact everything. You are trying to find time. So you are in a great speed. Now that is a stress. And you need to sustain. It is very difficult.
Do you get enough time to indulge in the sort of things that you enjoy? Because I believe you enjoy sports a lot. Scuba diving, snorkeling.
No, fortunately I somehow squeeze my time and I find time for them. And maybe because I'm mobile, I go for tours, meetings. And then I add it as a program.
So add work and pleasure together.
Try to do it. At times it gives you a bad image also, because as a minister you are not expected to do certain things. So the eyebrows get raised, but I think in times to come, with the exposure which we have, it would be accepted. Even when I used to wear sunglasses in my constituency in Bihar, I was criticized for that. Now they have accepted it. They were against me when I used to talk in English. Now they take it as a sense of pride that my minister can also speak in the local language, he can speak in English and they feel nice. So things are changing.
Every move of yours, every word of yours is carefully thought of, carefully planned.
That is terrible.
Is that part of your persona or is that part
of... That has just happened, because I think that is true for most of the politicians who do well. And we feel wherever we go for an aberration, wherever we speak which we are not supposed, I know exactly when I am speaking certain thing which I should not have spoken. I know it. And that is why a politician, they say, is heartless and things like that. Because...
Do you forgive and forget?
Yes, that I do. If I commit a mistake one side, I accept my mistake and I... And I generally try to forget things. Unless and until if someone has been... Yes, he's betrayed me.
So would you get back at them then?
Yes.
And how would you do that?
I don't know. Time and destiny decides it.
Now what's the next step as far as you're concerned? You've moved from regional politics to national politics. You are the Minister of State for Commerce and Industry. What is the next level of achievement that you're looking at? Where are you headed from here on?
No, that is very difficult. That is very difficult. I could be back on the streets tomorrow. I do not know. I will keep on trying. I'll keep on working. It's very difficult to say where you reach. I think I have got more than I deserved. I come from a state which is terrible today. What we talked of Taliban here, I see a different vision Taliban in my state. Because I have been born and brought up there. My state of Bihar is my strength. I want to see that state. And I think we can do it. It's beautiful. That state is enormous.
If the BJP were to lose the elections next time around and not be in power, what do you see yourself doing?
No. I must get it clear. BJP is not going to lose the elections anymore. The people of this country have realized now. And this is the time which is the biggest challenge for the BJP as such. Because we are midway and we are being hurdled not to achieve. We are going to overcome.
Well, that is an insight into the life of Rajiv Pratap Rudi, the Minister of State for Commerce and Industry. Time for us to head for a short break, but when we return, it's quiz time on the show. We'll be throwing the same questions at both our achievers to see how similar or different they are. Don't go away. Welcome back to Young Turks. Well, it's now time for 20 questions. What do our two personalities of the week think about critical issues like business, politics, money and success?
We put the same questions to Sanjay and Rudy, and here's what they have to say.
I think the success is building systems and processes which allow a company to work in a very professional manner as opposed to relying on individual strengths and weaknesses.
Being humble and modest.
Letting people who count on me down.
My success. It's most dangerous.
Money is like manure. If you spread it around, it does a lot of good, and if you pile it up, it stinks. The best thing that could ever happen to anyone.
An inevitable disaster.
Not a bit.
Woman.
Feeling happy every morning.
Kissing my daughters. Being too meticulous.
I think I don't listen enough.
First few hours in the morning sleep.
It's definitely the mornings, because you get up feeling fresh, young, and ready to take on all the challenges of the day.
So that brings us to the end of this episode. Shireen and I will be back next week, same time, same place, with two more next generation leaders in Young Turks.
Young Turks was presented by Ford Mondeo. Refined aggression.